He has banned the Chinese app. India is moving towards indigenous 5G network. The Prime Minister Modi has driven the one of the world's largest public digital goods infrastructure. You know, you have all the Aadhaar, Jam Trinity. Now you have the Cowin. So India has made a rapid advancement in the digital public goods. So the resolution thanks the Prime Minister for that and also gives suggestion as to what must be done in the future. And the core point is that all the foreign companies, without exception, have to follow all the rules and regulations of India. They have to follow all the orders of the Indian government. They cannot go back and say, well, our value systems are different. If your value systems are different, mm-hmm. get lost. As simple as that, you know. If you have to operate in India, you have to operate by the law. Not because on the basis of your differences in the value system and whatnot. India is governed by the Constitution of India, not by American Constitution. This point has been made very, very clear.
Namaste, good evening, and welcome to Chitti Media. My name is Sharan Setty. I'll be your host for today's current affairs show. Joining us today is Abhinav Prakash Ji. He's a popular face on the channel, the National Vice President of BJYM. Abhinav Ji, how are you? Namaste and welcome to Chitti Media.
Namaste, Sharan Ji. Namaste to all your audience. I'm good. Hope same is the news with every one of you.
Absolutely. We are doing fine too. And it's always a pleasure to have you here. Now, I've been seeing that you're on road, you're traveling. You were in Lucknow, you were in Ayodhya, and now you're back to Delhi. And the BJYM seems to be doing a lot of activities. So what is happening in your corner as far as the BJYM is concerned?
Well, as you know, that the Bharatiya Janata Yuva Morcha, the youth wing of the BJP, now has a very dynamic and very energetic president in the Tejasvi Surya. And he's a popular young leader of the country. And he has just revitalized the entire organization. The entire organization from top to down is now brimming with energy. And this was most visible in UP when we went there to Sri Ayodhya and then to join the executive meeting of the Uttar Pradesh. The amount of enthusiasm the people have, the young people have for the new president and his vision of India is just unparalleled. I mean, that is something which is rarely seen in political phenomena, that someone who's coming from South India, which still cannot speak the proper North Indian style Hindi, is right. So popular in the North India and the Hindi heartland. So I think a lot is going on in the BJYM. A lot more will happen in the coming years.
Right. Absolutely. When I was speaking to Tejasvi Bhaiya 2 years ago, and his Hindi was not as great as you see today. And today he's just fantastic. And in 2 years, it's a phenomenal change. And speaking Hindi in the Hindi heartland of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar is such a challenge, especially for those who come from South India. So I personally understand that while I interact with my friends from the North. And it's definitely no small feat. On that note, let us talk about the National Executive Meeting that you had recently, and three important resolutions have been passed. Now, coming to the first resolution, there is a resolution that the BJYM passed on digital sovereignty of India. Now, what made you come up with that resolution and why is this important? Could you please summarize this for us?
Yes, so this is a very important resolution which looks at the emerging trends in the polity, which will definitely impact the youth in the coming years. It is already impacting the youth in the large extent because they are the youth today is the internet generation. A large section of the youth is born after 2000, which was the full-fledged internet time period. So this is a resolution in which our president Tejasvi Suryavji was very keen, and he has been the prime mover of this resolution, even though I was the one who presented the resolution in the executive meet, but he's the one who is behind this resolution. And this basically takes cognizance of the emergence of the big tech companies, the multinational foreign companies who are operating without borders in the literal sense. Right. And they are not even following rules and regulations of the country they are operating in. We have seen that Twitter, we have seen other companies, how they violate the local laws, rules and regulations. They defy the government orders. They do not follow the local jurisdiction. They say our terms and conditions are superior than the constitutional rights of the citizens. We can do whatever we want. If you are on our platform, we can suspend you, suppress you, whatever. I mean, you do not have any right as a citizen of India because we enforce our own private rule. So this entire thing which is happening because of technological disruption, the fourth industrial revolution, is posing a very serious challenge to the sovereignty of India itself, and not just India, all the other countries. It's not India alone which is in this dealing with this problem. So like we have the land borders, we have water borders, we have the air borders of the country, we also now have the digital borders of the country. And to defend those digital borders and to enforce the sovereignty of the Indian state is of prime importance. So this resolution is basically focused at it. It takes notice of the work done by the Prime Minister Modi in the last 7 years. He has come up with various guidelines for the digital media platforms. He has banned the Chinese app. India is moving towards indigenous 5G network. The Prime Minister Modi has driven the one of the world's largest public digital goods infrastructure. You know, you have all the Aadhaar, Jam Trinity. Now you have the Cowin. So India has made a rapid advancement in the digital public goods. So the resolution thanks the Prime Minister for that and also gives suggestion as to what must be done in the future. And the core point is that all the foreign companies, without exception, have to follow all the rules and regulations of India. They have to follow all the orders of the Indian government. They cannot go back and say, well, our value systems are different. If your value systems are different, mm-hmm. get lost. As simple as that, you know. If you have to operate in India, you have to operate by the law. Not because on the basis of your differences in the value system and whatnot. India is governed by the Constitution of India, not by American Constitution. This point has been made very, very clear. So this is a very important resolution, and we had a very vibrant discussion in the executive meet. So in the executive meet, we have all the national office bearers, we have all the members of national executive, we have all the state presidents of the Yuva Morcha and the general secretaries. It was debated by the executive in detail. It was supported by the president of Rajasthan, president of Madhya Pradesh, and it was passed unanimously. So I think that's a great start.
Absolutely. I mean, this was something that was of a demand, especially after the Twitter controversy a few months ago. And it's good to see the BJYM come into action in terms of policy-oriented solutions for this. Now, another resolution that has been passed is called Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. And we've seen the BJYM cadre across the country since a couple of months ago, carrying out rallies, you know, asking for solutions, asking for vision for India at 2047. Why is this important, Abhinavji, and what does the BJYM plan to do?
Well, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav has been launched by Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi to celebrate the 75th year of independence of India. And this is not just a Sarkari program, let's be very clear. It's not just about, you know, going and organizing certain events here and there. Right. It's about reclaiming our history. It's about involving the people of India in the history writing of India. So the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav takes the history writing project outside the four walls of universities with their arcane and very intolerant academia as we have to the people. So it's about reviving the memories of the freedom fighters, countless freedom fighters, revolutionaries coming from every caste and community over the previous several centuries, not just against the British, but even before that, but mainly because this is about the freedom from the colonial rule. So we are focusing more on the last 200 years. There was not a single decade in the last 200 years of the British rule when there was not an armed uprising against the British rule. You have been told that you got freedom because some people protested against the British, went on the street, did some dharna pradarshan, shouted some slogan, Angrejo Bharat Choro, and India became independent. That's not true. That's simply not true. That also played a role, but that's not true, right? That's not the whole story. Yes. Every decade, there was an armed rebellion against the British, which was suppressed very brutally. All the regions of the country, all the caste, all the communities participated. They produced heroes, icons, revolutionaries who fought against the oppressive colonial rule. You have the Azad Hind Force, you have the naval mutiny of 1946, which was a pivotal point where, you know, then British in London said, well, we cannot no longer hold India, because once you have Indian National Army, now you have the Navy also revolting in Bombay and the people coming in support of the Navy. So all these things have been deliberately whitewashed in the history writing project done by the court historians of the Congress Party. So, you know, and the communist court historians, let's be very clear. So the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav is an opportunity which BJYM will, you know, use to take the history debate, history discussion to the people. It will celebrate, honor the local heroes, local icons, involve the local communities. There's so many castes which are, you know, which now come under scheduled caste, extremely backward caste, nomadic, denotified tribes and so on, semi-nomadic tribes. Their contribution has been completely washed from the history books. So we want to involve those communities, celebrate their icons and heroes and envision an India of 2047. So this is the call of the Prime Minister, which the BJYM will take forward in the forms of seminars, workshops, events, and lots of other political events across the country.
Right. Very brilliantly put, Abhinavji. But one of the central points to India's growth as a regional power and as a future superpower is its economic prowess. And I'm sure you would agree with me. Now, because of the Wuhan virus, our economy has suffered a lot of damage. And sometimes things are beyond our control. But it looks like the economy is slowly recovering. It's on its way back. The National Executive Meet also passed an economic resolution, and I found some of the points to be very interesting. For our viewers, could you tell what the vision is and what the resolution actually spoke about?
Yes. This resolution on economics was also passed. It was also debated in the executive. It was we had lots of suggestions coming in for it. It was a very vibrant discussion, and this is something which you don't find in other political parties, with the youth wing of those political parties take policy matters seriously and debate and discuss them. So this is really a party with a difference. And you know, allow me to do some campaigning for my own political party. So this economic resolution expresses the support of the BJYM to the economic reforms undertaken by the Prime Minister Modi and his government. So we have given full support to the mega reforms, unprecedented reforms, which the government has undertaken in almost every sector, from farm laws to the labor codes to the GST, to the opening up all of the sectors to the private participation, the establishment of bad banks, attempt to restructure the banking system of the country, and all those major reforms. So we say we fully support, as a youth organization, largest youth organization, we give full support to the economic reforms of the government. And then we also ask the government to implement the direct taxation reforms, and also, very importantly, the judicial reforms in the country. And so those are the two major political points which has been made. Reform the judiciary. The judiciary cannot hold back the democratic reforms like it has done in the case of NGAC. Other point is that the Yuva Morcha has asked all the state governments to increase the speed of filling up of the government vacancies. We have lots of vacancies which are struck due to really no reason. In some cases, apathy of the government's state bureaucracy. In some cases, there are some technical issues. In some cases, there is some matter pending in the court and so on. So we have urged all the governments, all the state governments, to please increase up the speed of filling of the government vacancies, because we have to augment the state capacity as well. We cannot have a state which does not have any presence on the ground. We have to have more doctors, policemen. We have to have more teachers. So all those things needs to be expanded. Mm-hmm. And another point which has been made is that there's lots of misinformation regarding the government policies on economics, whether it's farm laws, labor laws, you have all the kind of laws, like you have the asset monetization schemes. So lots of propaganda is being done by the people who want to keep India in the same Nehruvian mold of crony capitalism, corruption, socialist poverty, you know, the socialist rate of growth and all those things. So we are going to organize lots of events across the country, political meetings, seminars in the schools and colleges to explain these economic policies to the masses. So this is the third resolution passed from the BJYM National Executive Meet.
Right. It's a very interesting point that you bring up, because when brownfield assets are called as crown jewels, I think our economics is completely wrong and we need to reconsider that. No, what I wanted to ask is because UP has played a very important role in our civilization, in our history, and it is going to play a very important role in Bharat's growth. So what do you think Uttar Pradesh should be doing, and do you think it is on the right lines, and where do you see UP as an engine for economic growth for the future?
Well, Uttar Pradesh certainly is on the right path under the leadership of the Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, and the vision and direction shown by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. UP in the last 5 years has made great progress, whether it's infrastructure, the expressways. UP is building the largest number of expressways in the country. You have almost, more than a dozen medical colleges coming up in all the parts of UP, and these are the backward districts which did not even have proper hospitals. So that is being done at a very rapid pace. Infrastructure development has been quite impressive under Yogi ji. You have the lots of investment in manufacturing coming, especially in the western UP. All those mobile assembly lines and lots of other things are happening. And more importantly, the law and order is under control. So that was a major challenge, because if you don't have good law and order, then your business cannot work, your economy cannot function. A good law and order is the first condition for economic growth. It's a basic condition for the economic growth. So all those things have happened in the last 5 years. UP is going good in that sense. They have been massive implementation of the welfare schemes, very effectively implemented on the ground by the Chief Minister Yogi. Whether they were state schemes or the schemes of the central government, they have been effectively implemented. There is the Awas Yojana, water connectivity, you name it, you have it, right? So lots of things are happening. The living quality is increasing. The economic opportunities are increasing. Infrastructure is being built for the future. Law and order is under control. So I think UP is on the right path. But given that it has a population of almost 23 crore or something, whatever you do is not enough. We have to keep doing more and more every day. And that is, I think, what the resolve of the BJP is. And I'm pretty sure that BJP is going to win the next elections. And under the Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, we will have 5 more glorious years of peace, very importantly, and economic growth, which will transform the Uttar Pradesh. Now, UP should focus a lot on manufacturing. It has a huge population, large labor force, cheap labor force. It can do really well in the manufacturing. And I think the government is also focused on promoting manufacturing in Uttar Pradesh, which is a good start. You have the defense corridor through the Jhansi. You have Western UP belt. Lot of work is being done in the Eastern UP, which has neglected so far for the last 70 years. So I think UP has a bright future.
Thank you so much for that answer. Now, Abhinavji, I make it a point to read your articles and I find them very interesting. Now, one of the recent articles you wrote was for Open Magazine, which was titled Modi at 20. I think the theme of the magazine was that. And then you write in that article about how Bharat had robust infrastructure will become a very, very important role. It will play a very important part in our growth as a power in the future. Can you please elaborate on this?
Well, in that article, I wrote how the Prime Minister Modi is redefining India. And one of the aspects is the infrastructure development. So we have seen the speed of the highway construction is all-time high, is unprecedented. You have the air connectivity increasing. You have the Uran Yojana. You have the waterways being built. You have lots of work being done on the railways, on the basic infrastructure, and so on. Now, when you talk about the nation and nationalism, infrastructure plays a very important role. It's not without reason that you have Mahabharat and Ramayana on the Uttarapath and the Dakshinapath, because once you have the trade routes, when you have the infrastructure, roads through which you can travel, it brings people together. It creates the sense of belonging to the place. And historically, infrastructure has played a very important role in defining a nation, or what is a rashtra, what is a community, what is a civilization. I have mentioned the Chinese experience. It's when the I think Sui dynasty built a grand canal. It's only then the North China and the South China became more similar to each other, that the entire Chinese identity got consolidated Much more strongly than before, because South China was very different from North China up until that point. So Grand Canal, because it made the transportation easier, travel easier through the waterways, it brought China together. This is what the Roman infrastructure did. Roman roads were famous in the Roman Empire. So they spread the Roman culture, civilization in all the corners of the empire. So infrastructure is very important. Even in the modern period, in the last 200 years, the development of railways has played a very important role in the rise of the nation states. Now, by strengthening infrastructure, waterways, airways, railways, highways, and you name it, Prime Minister Modi is basically redefining the experience of the Indians, right? What it actually means to be an Indian. You are living in Karnataka, you can easily travel to Delhi. You are living in... I was talking to lots of people from Northeast, because our presidents of the BJYM, other party members had come from the national executive, and they were telling us that how easier it has become for them to travel now than before. In the last 5 years, so much of work has been done in Northeast. The travel has become much more easier within the Northeastern states and also with the, let's say, Delhi or other parts of the country. And that redefines, you know, what it means to be in India, because you are interacting, there's greater exchange of ideas, there's greater trade and commerce that consolidates the national identity, that consolidates the civilizational consciousness. So this is a great contribution of Prime Minister Modi. He's redefining what it means to be Indian, that you can fly on such a cheap rate from one part of the country to another, you know, is changing the outlook, the horizon of even the middle class people of this country, because air travel was so expensive, you know, only few could travel, but now everyone can travel. I've seen on the airplanes, frankly speaking, you know, and I say when you hear on the airplane that bhai sahab ladies ko windows wali seat de de, then you know what is changing on the ground, right? So the crowd, which is actually a lower middle class or the neo middle class, that is also now using the air service. They can afford it, if not every time, but certainly they can afford it once in a while. And that is changing a lot of things of what it means to be an Indian.
Right. Thank you so much for sharing all these insights, Abhinavji. And we do look forward to more activities and insights from Yuva Mocha. And we will be calling you on the show, of course. And I hope you can take some time out for us. And thank you for so beautifully putting the vision for India and what Prime Minister Modi has been doing. And thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Sharan. And thank you to your entire team.
Namaste, Abhinavji. Have a nice day. And to all our viewers, please do like, share, and subscribe to Chitti Media if you like this video. And we will be bringing out more current affairs show. Until then, this is your host, Sharan Sethi, signing off.
Please remember to subscribe to us and switch on the notifications for this channel. For our other social media links, more content, and to support our work, please visit citti.net. Dhanyavaad. Namaskar.